lecture by Wolfgang Lechner.
Let's continue with the last session. So in the previous session, we have seen, so to say, some direct aspects about quantum annealing. And in this last session, I would like to talk now about implementations. And in particular, so we have seen that the Hamiltonian that we are interested in has this form. You know, we need some qubits which have a single particle sigma x, single particle sigma c, and then they need this interaction sigma c, sigma c. And we have also seen that if we want to make this somehow general, then this sigma c interaction must be infinite range. And in other words, this means we have to be able to program every element of our JHA matrix. And this is something very unnatural in our usual setups, no? Because it means that we have to be able to individually address interactions between qubits which are very far apart. So usually we have Hubbard models or transverse Ising models or something like this, and we are often interested only in nearest neighbor interactions. So we have some grid, and qubits would only interact with nearest neighbors. And that's also the natural way qubits interact. You know, they don't have this arbitrary infinite range interaction. And so this is a fundamental challenge in the field. And there's a company that actually built Hamiltonians like this, and the way they did, so this is E-wave, and the way they did is they used this superconducting flux qubits. And in superconducting flux qubits, the qubits would be defined as the flux that goes through a wire. And this means you can basically elongate your qubits to a large extent. So this means the loop in which your flux is defined can be physically really stretched out. And that's what they actually did. So they made qubits which have this elongated form. And from this they designed a grid where you have qubits which can interact with four other qubits. So in this case, each of these elongated objects and where they meet each other, they have a coupling. So in this case, you would have 8 qubits, four qubits here and four qubits here, and here you have the interactions between them. And this is what they call the chimera graph. And starting from this quasi-nonlinear interaction, so here you have like interaction between one and four other qubits, which is already somehow challenging. You can actually make longer and longer interactions by just defining or by just combining a few qubits to effective single qubits. So this means you just make a very strong interaction between some of them, which means they will always point in the same direction. And by this you can basically make the graph longer and longer. However, as you can see here, if you want to do this, it actually becomes already a challenging part on how to embed an arbitrary graph into this chimera graph. And so to say, this is the state-of-the-art solution. And in this talk, I would like to discuss how we can actually improve this. And in particular, I would like to show you how we can open up other qubit platforms to quantum computing. So this is a very unusual setup, no, that we can, that we are actually able to make our qubits some elongated objects. Usually, if you have transmons or Rydberg atoms or algebraic atoms, ions, polar molecules, or anything like this, we will always have a situation where we have qubits which interact with their nearest neighbors. They are maybe on some grid, and they will interact only with nearest neighbors, and all the interactions will be more or less the same. So it's not easy to design systems like this where we can really handle it. And in this session, I would actually like to show you a new approach. So this is published in this paper here. How you can actually translate this into a different Hamiltonian, so not the infinite range spin class, but a different Hamiltonian which you can actually then implement in all these platforms. Okay, so I will show you the main idea first, and then I will show you the derivation. What we actually have shown in this paper is that you can take this Hamiltonian, or what we've shown in this paper is an alternative Hamiltonian which can handle all optimization problems. So in the previous sessions I've shown you that if you can build this Hamiltonian, you can encode any optimization problem. What we have shown is that you can encode the same optimization problems if you can build this Hamiltonian. And let me show you some features of this Hamiltonian. So first of all, this Hamiltonian has now three terms instead of two terms. So in the spin glass formulation of quantum annealing, we had this trivial part and then we had the spin glass part. Now in this Hamiltonian, we have three terms instead of two. And these three terms are similarly the term which contains the trivial part. And then there is a part which is now a single qubit part. So here we have just a local field acting on qubits. And they call this part the JIJ, the J part, so the local field of J, because these are the only things that I will have to program. So the remarkable thing here is that we have translated problem from programming interactions between qubits to a problem where we have to program only local fields acting on qubits. So this is from an engineering point much simpler. And then there is a third part, and this part are four-body interactions. So these are local four-body interactions on plaquettes. And this is also something that I will show you that we can actually do. Now the price that you pay is that the number of qubits is quadratically larger. So here we have n qubits, and here we need n times n minus 1 half qubits. So the price that we pay is we need more qubits. What we gain is, first of all, is these features. So we can make an all-to-all interaction matrix in local fields. So instead of programming interactions, we are actually programming local fields. Then the architecture has only local interactions, so geometrically local interactions, on a two-dimensional grid. And this actually allows us to implement quantum annealing in many current qubit platforms, including transmons, algebraic atoms, hybrid systems, and so on. And there's also some error tolerance, because we have increased the number of qubits, we actually also gain some error tolerance. So let me now guide you through the derivation on how we get from one Hamiltonian to the other. So let's start with our spin glass formulation of the problem. So in my slides now, I will have the spin glass qubits, which I will call the logical qubits. They will be blue, and the ones that are physically built, the physical qubits, will be green. But these are really just qubits, and I just chose different colors to distinguish. So the first step that we do is we want to represent our qubit system not by the qubits itself, but by the relative orientation of two qubits. So this means we translate from two blue ones to one green one. And the way we do this is we say if the qubits are pointing in the same direction, then we declare this qubit up. If two are pointing in different directions, we declare this spin down. So this means if we take now this part of the Hamiltonian, where we have this double sum ij, jij is in the C sequence. If we write this now in these new variables, we immediately get a single sum over n squared elements of these new qubits, which represent relative orientations, with a local field. But now if we count the number of degrees of freedom, we see that here, on this side, we have only n degrees of freedom, while here we have really n times n minus 1 half degrees of freedom. So the number of elements is the same, but the number of degrees of freedom is different. This means on this side we have to compensate k minus n degrees of freedom. So we have to take out k, so n squared minus n degrees of freedom. And now the question is, what are these constraints? So how can I take out these degrees of freedom? These constraints are conditions on closed loops in the original model. So let's do a translation table. No? Imagine we have three original spins, and they are connected via this graph, which is a closed loop. You know, I go 1, 2, 3, 1, 5. So this means our new qubits, I have also three new qubits. No? So I have three original qubits and I have three new qubits. So I can represent this system either by the qubits, or I can represent it by all the relative orientations. Now if I have the situation up, up, up in the original spin, then I can translate this. This will be up, up, up in the new spins, no? Because they are the same orientation. These two are same orientation. These two are same orientation. So this means 1, 1, 1 will translate to 1, 1, 1 in the new cube. Now if all spins are down, this will also be up, up, up in the new spins, no? Because they are the same direction. They are same direction. They are same. Now let's do an example. Let's take down, down, up. So this means 1, 2 would be same orientation, so this would be spin up. 2, 3 would be opposite orientation, so this would be spin down. And 1, 3 would be also opposite orientation, so this would be also. So for example, down, down, up would translate to up, down, down. And so on. So I can continue with my translation table. And maybe at some point I arrive at up, up, down on this side. No? So let's try to translate this back. So 1 and 2 are same orientation because this is up. 1 and 3 are same orientation because this is up. Now 2 and 3 have to be different orientation, but that's not possible because we said 1, 2 and 1, 3 are same orientation. So this means this configuration on the right hand side has no correspondence on the left hand side. And this is actually, we can formulate this general rule in a sentence, or in an English sentence. So in each closed loop in the original model, the number of spin downs of the new variables has to be even or zero. So on this side here, we can only have configurations which have an even number of spin downs or no spin downs. Intuitively, this is very easy to understand. Imagine you have a closed loop and you flip one original spin, then you will always flip two of the new spins. And no matter in what combination you do this, this always leads to the fact that on the right and on this side, the number of spin downs must be. And now this is true for every closed loop, so not just for closed loops of three. This is also true for closed loops of four or any closed loop in the system. So no matter which one you choose, if you go back to the original spin, the number of spin downs in this new representation must be even. And now this is something that we can translate into a physical constraint. So we can take our physical qubits, so these are the example that we looked at, this was 1, 2, 2, 3, and 1, 3. And now we can add a term to the Hamiltonian, which is just the product of 1, 2, 2, 3, 1, 3. And if we put there a minus in front, then this gives us an energy penalty if we have an odd number of spin down, and no penalty if we have even numbers. Now this is true for every closed loop, and this means, for example, if I take this loop, so 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, 1, 4, then I can introduce a four-body term, which gives us this constraint. So this means the length of my loop translates to the k locality, so how many spins are involved in my constraints. Okay, now, the only challenge here is which closed loops should I choose now? And because there is an enormous number of closed loops that I have available. You know, I can take any of these closed loops and make constraints out of this, but I only need a few of them. I only need k minus n out of them. I don't need all of them. So the question is which one should I choose? And I make now some rules. You know? I say, okay, first of all, I would like to take into account each of the new qubits. If I take into account all of them, then this allows me to make a fully programmable all-to-all GIG matrix. So I could take a reduced set, but I would like to first solve the general one. So I want to take into account all of them. And the second rule is I would like to, so to say, have my closed loops go through the original spins the same number of times. So I would like to choose my closed loops in such a way that like not going through the one, for example, all the time, but I would like to equally go through all of the original spins the same number of times. And the third one, and this is really the challenging one, is I would like to select them in such a way that the constraints that I get out, so these constraints, that they are completely local. So this means if I build my physical device, I don't want any non-local interactions. I only want nearest neighbor interactions. And this is sort of say that actually the challenging part. And the question is, does something like this actually exist? And it turns out there's only one solution to this problem. And I would like to guide you through this. So the basic building block of the architecture is a closed loop, which looks like this. So it looks like this. So I go one to the right, two back, three to the right, two back. So let's do this in detail. So for each of these connections, I write a physical qubit. And I order them now by the difference between these two numbers. So I have like, this will be in this representation that the closest ones, and this will be then the ones that are further apart. So this means I start with 2, 3, which means they have distance 1. Then I go 2 back, which means I have the 1, 3, which has distance 2. Then I go 1, 4, which has distance 3, and then I go back 2, 4, So with this I have now a single constraint and I can make this a four-body term. So this will be my first four-body term. Now in this example I have six original spins, which means I need in total 10 constraints. So now we have one. Now taking this building block, I just move it one to the right. So first I start with 2, 3, now I start with 3, 4. This means I put 3, 4 here. And then I see that the 2, 4 is already there. So I just reuse it, and then I have 2, 5, 3, 5. So this means I have my second cat. And if this I move once through the system, I have the third. Now, the second building block is, I take the same pattern, but now I move it one apart. So I stretch it by one. So this means I start now with going two to the right, three back, four to the right, three back. So I've taken the same pattern, just move it one apart. And now, if I look at the elements, let's look at the elements. So I have two, four, I have the one, four, two, five, one, five. And now I can see that this is exactly that three of these elements are already there. No? So these are, this is the corner that we share from these two plaquettes that we had before. So three of them are right there, which means I only need to add the fifth one up there. And this actually makes it very compact, no? Because this is now true for all the elements. Now I move this one to the right again, and I can actually fill up this corner. And then I stretch it by one again, and then I put the 1, 6. So with this I have now 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 four body terms, but I needed a total 10 constraints, and I also left out two elements. I left out the 1, 2, which I will put here, and I left out the 5, 6, which I put here. And then if I look at the bottom row, I see that here I have my three body terms, no? So this was the loop that we looked at originally, it's the 1, 2, 1, 3, 2, 3. So here I have a free body term, here I have a free body term, here I have a free body term. So this means that the model that I get out in the end looks like a triangle. It has a lot of four body terms, and on one side of the triangle I have free body terms. Now I can also make this free body term a four body term by just fixing here a plus one. So I put here a spin or a qubit which is always pointing in the plus one direction, and then this becomes all four body terms. So this makes it for some systems easier if all the interactions are the same. Okay, so this means what I have now is I have enlarged my Hilbert space, so I have more qubits. But what I've gained is that I have now a system where I can program local fields to have this infinite range J and J matrix. And all the interactions are the same. So they are problem-independent interactions. And I can turn on and off interactions in the logical model by just turning on and off local fields here. So this means that the connectivity of the problem is really now part of the input. And this is, from a technical point of view, I think a huge advantage. So just to summarize, we have now a Hamiltonian where I have three parts, my trivial sigma x part, then a local field sigma c, plus a term which contains four body interactions, and these four body interactions all live on plaquettes which are mirror stable. And if I want, so just to say this is of course also scalable, and if I want to add a qubit, this just adds a row here on the side. So if I have a seventh qubit, this just becomes a row on this side, and so on. Okay, and now I can look at the spectrum, for example. So here I've now plotted the time-dependent spectrum in the annealing. If I program the problem in the spin glass, which I can actually now do because it's infinite range, or if I program it in this Hamiltonian. And what we can see is that this, for example, is the spin glass representation of the same problem. And what we can see is that the quantum path at which we go from the sigma x to the sigma c term is completely different, no? So they are not the same. And what is the same is the final state. So this is where I encode my problem. So here I've drawn these lines just to show that these are really the same values, but the way I get there is completely different. But this is the only thing that counts, no? So I don't care what exactly the quantum path is, how I approach this. All I'm interested in is the ground state of the problem.
And so to say, this is just an illustration that this is really a different model. The reason why this is a different model is that the sigma x term that we introduced has now a different meaning. So the translation that we did was on the problem Hamiltonian, and then we just added the sigma x quietly again. What this actually means is the sigma x has now a different meaning, no? Because the qubits represent relative orientations of spins in the original model. Now a sigma x term on these new variables means something like that in the original model, two spins are in a superposition of being pointing in the same direction and pointing in a different direction. So this has no direct analogy to the original sigma x, which is spins pointing. So that's why the quantum path looks completely different.
And is it just luck that the gap looks a lot bigger, or?
Yeah, so that here, so this is just for illustration. In this case, the gap got smaller, which means it will be worse. And because, so to say,
oh, sorry, the new one's on the left.
This is the new one.
Ah.
Yeah, so. Yes. But actually, there's a lot of ways one can improve this. And this is something that we are currently working on, how efficiency compares in the two models. So because the quantum path is completely different, one has to re-examine all the knowledge also during the path again. And there's actually some very interesting physics in there as well.
Yes. But how much of the transverse part actually is producing dynamics that's just flipping among different gauges rather than actual gauge invariant states?
Well,
that's
so
that's a little question.
Yeah. So this goes hand in hand somehow, no? Because let me phrase things. So these new sigma x terms, they have a very strange role in the original model, no? Because what this means is they would individually flip, so to say, the connection 1, 2 between being same direction and different direction. Now, you cannot individually flip a single connection. So this must be self-contained somehow. So you cannot take your spin model and say the connection 1, 2 is now different. You actually, if you flip the connection 1, 2, you have to flip everything that is attached to 1 or 2. And this means, translated into this model, it means that the original sigma x term becomes a product sigma x along particular lines. And these lines you can see by connecting the same indices. So imagine you want to flip the original spin free. No? This means you have to flip all relative orientations that have the free in it. So if we follow this, this will be this one, this one, this one, this one. So this will be aligned like this. No? And if you follow the four, it will go like this. So this means the new spins that actually do flips and would do flips such that all gauges are again conserved, they would have to do it along these lines. So, and this means these local flips, they somehow have to arrange with n other qubits to again satisfy the constraints. On the other hand, in annealing, this is not exactly how it works. No, you're not in the classical limit and do flips, but you're actually going through this massive phase transition. And this is where one can actually get some improvement. So it is not automatically clear just because you have more qubits that the efficiency gets worse. No, because you can actually, and so to say, what we're currently looking at is how you can actually use these new spin flips
for more efficient. So, is there any other questions to this mapping? This is sort of saying the core of this session. Let me now tell you a little bit about what's around this. So first of all, we have only talked about the pair interactions yet. You know? So we have actually only looked at this term. But maybe in the original model, we also have a single particle terms. Now this is something that we can add trivially by just adding a row of particles on this side. So we just declare the first qubit to be outside of the system and be something like a generator for a local field. And because we have control of all the interactions, we can just say that so this will be then the local field acting on 2, this will be the local field acting on 3, and so on. So this means if we want to add a local field, we just add one row of qubits on this side, so which has exactly n entries. Now, remarkably, it also works in the other direction. So it turns out we can also make 3-body terms, 4-body terms, 5-body terms, and so on and so on, with exactly the same Hamiltonian that we've seen before, but with a different geometry. And if we want to have all-to-all 3-body terms, what comes out is a graph that looks like this. So the strategy is again the same. We translate, now in this case, 3 qubits into a new single qubit. So if all are pointing in the same direction, it's up. If one is down, it's down, and so on and so on. And now, this means our qubits have now 3 indices, which are here. And now, one can actually arrange them on this particular shape, which is like a cut out of a square. And the indices, or the qubits, are arranged now in such a way that so they form cubes, and the constraints, they actually act on the faces of the cubes. So instead, so before we had a two-dimensional geometry, and the constraints would act on the four-body terms. Now we have again the same four-body terms, but now they act on the faces of cubes. And the reason why this works is the following. So we have chosen the indices in such a way that on each side there is always one index which is identical for all four of them. So here I've magnified one. So take, for example, the front one. Here, the index one, the first index is always one. Now, this means these indices are products of 3 spins. No? So this means, for example, this would be 1 times 2 times 5. This would be 1 times 3 times 5, and so on. Now the 4-body terms, the 4-body term is a product of these guys. So this means we have here the sigma C1 enters with a power of 4 in this product. And this means it's always plus 1. So this means we can take out every index which appears on all 4 sides. And because of this, we can have then the same 4-body term as before, no? Because then it's just we have just 2 indices, and these 2 indices form closed loops. So this is 2-5, 3-5, 3-6, 2-6. So this is a closed loop of 2 indices. So that's why it's the same constraint. And this is true for every side. So on each side in this geometry, you will find that there is always one index which is identical. And another. And this gives us also a very nice intuitive way to look at it, no? Because now the 3-body terms have become a 3-dimensional object. And if you look at the back of this object, you see this triangle again, no? So this was this original triangle. So that the back side of this 3-dimensional object are the 2-body interactions. And the single body terms are aligned on this. So this means that the k locality, so this means how many sigma c's are part of the Hamiltonian, become the dimensionality of the model. So the k locality becomes the dimensionality of the model. And now this means if we want to go to four body or five body terms, we can also do this with the same trick, but then we need a four-dimensional object, and that's not possible. However, we can do less than all-to-all four-body interactions and so on. But if you want to do all-to-all interaction, then three bodies, so we say the maximum, because we have then the three-dimensional graph. But again, everything is local, so all interactions are local, and we get three-body interactions. So this means also the k-locality of the original model is independent of the k-locality of the new model. Now, the readout. So what would I actually read out? So as we've seen, our original model had n qubits, which means the information should be stored in n qubits. Now the new this new architecture has n squared qubits, which means we don't need to read out all of them. No? So, for example, if I want to read out the system, I could read out these guys, no? 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 4, 1, 5. So this means if I know 1, 2, 1, 3, 1, 4, 1, 5, 1, 6, then I know everything about the system up to global inversion. Now, I could also read out these guys, for example, no? 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 4, 4, 5, 5, 6. I would also know everything about the system. And this is true for any spanning tree in the system, no? So I could, for example, read out this spanning tree, which will be this qubit, this qubit, this qubit, this qubit. Also everything about the system. So the only condition is I should not forget one, and it should not break into two subs. Otherwise, any spanning tree I can read out. Now, this actually allows us to do a trivial error correction, like a naive one, let's say. Let's do the following calculation. Let's say in the original model we had n qubits, in the new one we have n squared qubits. Now, let's say we have the same rate, the same quality of our qubits. Now, this means if we write the success probability, so this should be a minus. We can write it as 1 minus the sum of the rate times the total time times n. On this side, we would have 1 minus the rate times the time times n squared. So it's n squared verse. However, there is also an information content of each cube. I call this here IS. And information content means if I have an error here in one qubit, what is the probability that I still get the right result? If I do here a spin flip, the probability is zero, no? Because if I flip here a qubit, I'm definitely getting the wrong result. However, here, if I flip 1, 2, 4, for example, then there's still a chance that I don't need this for my readout. No? For example, if I read out this line or this line, I will never read it. So this means I can do a statistics on these readouts. So I can say, well, let's say I do all the readouts and I calculate the information content of each qubit. And you're probably not surprised that the information content of each qubit is exactly 1 over n squared. So this compensates a 1 over n squared. So this compensates exactly the n squared. So in other words, I have a chance if I have n original qubits and I pick one of the new ones, then there are still n minus 1 other ones which hold the information. So this means, alone from this very naive way of looking at it, I already compensated the quadratic overhead. But it turns out that one can do even much better. And this is a this is work that John Preskill put forward. So we are very proud about this because they did this very fast after we published our paper. So it turns out that in this architecture, there's actually one can actually do a belief propagation. And the main idea here is that one actually makes use of the closed loops that we have not used yet. So remember, for this construction, we have selected a certain number of closed loops. So we have taken this particular one, so we go one to right, two back, and so on. Now, there are still these other closed loops in there, and for them, also the rule must be satisfied that the number of spin down must be even. So this means if I take any closed loop that I've not used, for example, 1, 2, 2, 4, 1, 3, then for this closed loop, the number of spin down must be even. And also for this loop, it must be even. So this means I can now say, well, if I want to know the value of 1, 2, I could either just read out the 1, 2, or I could do the opposite. No, I could read out every member of closed loops within 1, 2, except for 1, 2. No? So this means if I read out, for example, 1, 3 and 2, 3, and the sum of them, the sum of them is has an odd number of spin down, I know that this must be spin down, because the total number is. And that's true for every closed loop. And I have an exponential number of these closed loops. No? So this means if I want to know 1, 2, I could read out 2, 3, and 1, 3, 2, 4, and 1, 4, and so on. So this would be the loops of 3. Then I can also take the loops of 4. No, I can read 2, 3, 4, 1, and so on. So I just take every loop that contains 1, 2, and read out everything except for 1, 2. And if I do this, it turns out that there's an exponential error correction. So what this means is, so this is data from their paper, graph from their from this paper here. So here what they've done is, on the x-axis you see the number of qubits, and the different colors are different error rates. So they have just randomly picked, in this case, for example, every fifth qubit is and then it turns out that if you read out the system with this belief propagation, you can actually correct for these errors, and this takes your exponential. So this means the larger the system, the better you can correct it. Now, this sounds very good. However, we have to keep in mind that that this is just a classical error correction. So this is more or less correcting errors after the final sweep. So what we have not gained is a real quantum error correction. This would be, of course, the dream that during the sweep we can actually correct for errors. This is something that might be, in principle, not possible. So keep in mind that there's a very nice error robustness. However, it only applies to the final state and is more or less a classical error correction and not a quantum one. And it is not obvious how you would translate something like this into a quantum error correction. So this is an open question for Yami. Okay. Then here I just want to show that if you have less than all to all, you can also make different graphs. No, for example, so that you always get the same Hamiltonian. So always get the Hamiltonian which has this form. You know, you have the single paradoxism X, single paradoxism C, and the constraints. But then the logical problem can look completely different. And this translates simply to different geometries in your architecture. You know, for example, if you have next nearest neighbors, you're basically cutting off this pyramid at some point. Or if you have a so-called tripartite graph, which means you have three rows, and every qubit is connected to everybody in the other two rows, but not within the same row. Then this actually translates to the carbon lattice. Or another important one is the bipartite graph because of machine learning. If you have a bipartite graph, it actually becomes a rectangle. So bipartite graph means you have two rows and everybody is connected to everybody in the other row and not connected within the same row. And usually you have the connection and the biases. So bias is just a local field on the qubits. Then this actually translates to an enormously simple geometry. This really becomes a rectangle in this new architecture. So it almost seems like this parity architecture is made for the machine learning. Just if you make this deeper, it actually becomes very interesting. Also, if you have now a deep network, which means you just have a series of bipartite graphs, then this becomes like a ladder structure. No? So let's label these layers A, B, C, D, E. Then our first triangle would be A and B, no? Because the new qubits represent interactions between A and B, so you would have here A1 to 4, B1 to 3. No? So this will be this rectangle. And now the next one we can actually write below it, because then we have the interactions between B and C. So this will be these guys. And then the next ones will be here, B and D. So this becomes a ladder like this. And you can also think what happens if I fill up these guys. No? If I fill up the rectangle, then I get interactions between D and A. So that's maybe even something interesting for machine learning if you have additional connectivity. Okay, so let's look at the time. Okay, I think we have 10 more minutes, actually. Are there any questions about this? Then maybe I'll just talk a little bit about implementations. So one thing that you're probably thinking about, okay, this is all nice, but what do I do with these four-body interactions? So four-body interactions is always difficult. And I would like to show you, because these are classical four-body interactions, so sigma C, sigma C, sigma C interactions, one can actually build them. And the strategy is the following. So in this architecture, we have the advantage that we are only interested in the ground state. So we are only interested in the lowest state. We don't care what the upper ones are. They can even be wrong. We are only interested in the ground state. In the ground state, all the constraints are satisfied. So this means we can look at the spectrum of this four-body terminal. And if you look at the spectrum, then we see that it has two levels. So the constraint can be satisfied or not satisfied. And we can look at the states corresponding to this. The ones that do not satisfy the constraint have an odd number of spin downs, which means there's only two possibilities. So you can have four spins up, one spin down, or one spin up with three down. And they are fourfold degenerate, because so the way I can arrange, so this spin down can be either here, 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 or here, or this spin up can be here, here. So I have four of these and four of these. For the ones that I want, so the satisfying one, I have one combination where all spins are up, I have one where all are down, and then there are six possibilities with two up and two down. So the way I can arrange two up and two down on this will be sixfold. So this means so from the total I have 16 states, eight are satisfying, eight are non-satisfying, and they have different degeneracies. No? They have fourfold degeneracy, and here's single, sixfold, and single. Now, because of this, because we are interested in annealing, we are actually only interested in the ground state, because the ones that do not satisfy the constraints, which are don't satisfy the gauge, so to say, they are unphysical in the original model. So actually I allow to actually split them up. So I don't care what exactly their energy is, I just want them to be separated from the ground state. And for the ground state, I want it to be really exactly the same. So I want to have this degeneracy. And now, for the even ones, this means I could make the so-called stabilizer operators. So what this means is, so if I only require that the even parities are degenerate and the other ones I don't care, then I can write this in the following form. So I can first write the sum of the sigma c's. And this means I can either, the right ones are either minus 4, 0, or 4. And then I add a q-treat in the middle with a factor of 4. So q-treat means I can have minus 1, 0, plus 1 with a factor of 4. This cancels exactly, and if I square this, I get the constraint. Now I can say, okay, I don't want to build a q-treat. Okay. Now, nobody wants to build a q-treat, and that's why in this paper, the Simon Benjamin group actually has shown how our architecture can be written also in the odd parity subspace. So what we've seen before, we have for each constraint, we have the even subspace. With a very simple trick, one can actually make every constraint an odd constraint. Now odd constraints are different, no? Because odd constraints have now in the ground state this more symmetric version. No? We have this three up, one down, or one up, three down. And there's only two of them, and they have the same degeneracy. This means if we write now this stabilizer again, then the sum of the sigma c's can only be minus one or plus. Minus 2 or plus 2, and this is something that I can compensate with a single q bit. So this means if I have 2 times sigma c of this zilla plus the sum square, then I can actually make a Hamiltonian that has this value. And now, the way how I can get from an even parity representation to odd parity representation is actually very simple. All I need to do is flip every fourth qubit. Because imagine I flip this one, the local fluid from minus 1 to plus 1, then this actually makes this constraint, this constraint, this constraint, this constraint, odd parity. Now if I would flip also this one, I would repair these two. This means I actually have to go to the fourth one of this one. This means if I flip every fourth qubit, then all my constraints become odd parity, and I can use this trick to decompose all my four body terms. And now if I do this, so I've written down this stabilizer, and now I just multiply out the squares, I get only parity energies. No? So I have here this Godzilla, which I put now in the middle, and I have only parity directions. And you can also see that they all have the same sign, but some of them have a factor 2 in front. And the ones that have a factor 2 in front are the ones that interact with the Godzilla. So this means what I have to build is something where I have my four qubits, I have a conditional Godzilla, and I have only pair interactions. And if I do this, I have my four body constraint. Now, these terms I can actually split up into three objects. So I can say, okay, I have the interactions along the qubits on the outside, these guys, plus I have the interactions with the Godzilla, which are factor 2, plus I have these interactions, which are, along the diagonal. And all these three terms actually can be arranged on a Brady lattice. No? So they form individual sub-lattices. which are very simple. And with this strategy, I can actually make a very simple implementation. So now, before I go to this, I would also like to say that there is a certain stability in this. So usually if you hear about decomposing four-body terms into two-body terms, then there is some fine-tuning left. Here it turns out that there is actually some robustness to the to errors. And with this, I mean the following. Imagine we have now these three terms, which I can somehow engineer. And now I say that the interaction between these two, these four, is exactly one. So this is sort of say my base value. But now the interaction between the qubits and the ancilla and these interactions along the axis, they are not perfect. You know? They are not two and one exactly, but they have some error. So I just call this alpha and beta. And now, because I'm only interested in the ground state, it turns out that I'm robust to having errors in alpha and beta. So what I've plotted here is the energy as a function of alpha for a certain beta. So beta is already somehow wrong. If beta would be exactly one, then these two lines would be on top of each other. So beta already has some error. And now if I look at the line for the correct ones, so the correct ones are the ones where I have three down, one up, plus the ancilla up, or three up, one down, plus the ancilla down. So these are the ones which keep me the right size space. And it turns out that they are separated from all the others in a whole window of alpha. So I have, so to say, the maximal separation at two. So this was the factor two that we had here. But if this is not exactly two, but more or less than two, it does not change the order of the levels. It only changes this value a little. So this means my constraint becomes weaker, but it does not, so to say, change the order of my level. This means there is also some robustness in this. And now for Rydberg atoms, so this is something that was worked out by Alex Gladstone and Eric von Weinen mainly, which we published in this paper. We have actually considered this setup that Mark Safran has. So this is a Rydberg setup where he has two species of atoms which are within each other. And with this, we can now design exactly the interactions that we need. No? So we can design interactions between rubidium atoms at distance 1, between rubidium atoms at distance square root of 2, and between rubidium and cesium atoms, which then form this ancilla. And the way we did this was a method that Rick von Weinen did with Thomas Bohl, is this so-called molecular levels. So these are resonances which we design exactly in such a way that they form exactly on these lattice distances. So the interactions here look like this, that we have this is the interaction. So these are the energy levels, and the interactions that we get out are then really peaked at chosen distances. No? And this is the interaction between the rubidium and cesium. So this would be this one, which has this factor 2. And this would be then the interactions on the lattice sides. This is something square root of 2/2. And this is the square root of 2, which gives us then this additional. So with this setup, we only need a single or two lasers to actually excite these interactions. And this allows us to build a fully coherent annealer with all-to-all connectivity in such a model. And maybe due to time, we can make this very short. Very, very short. We have also an implementation of transmons, so if you're interested in this, please go to this paper. There we've shown how you can actually decompose the four-body terms, particularly for transmons, but we have a setup where the interactions are not just the same, but they are also fully planar. You know? Because what is a bit annoying for transmons is here this interaction that goes over another one. So this is not a planar graph. But we have actually also found a decomposition which allows you to make it fully planar. And with this you can actually make it hopefully also with superconducting qubits. As a last point, I just also want to mention that actually also many other groups thought about how to implement this architecture with other qubit platforms. So this in this paper around Paul Warburton in London, they looked at flux qubits. The IBM group working on so-called driven fixed frequency transmons, and a very recent one by Shruti Puri from the Blaze group, which I also just put on the archive, is on how to do this with driven Carillon linearities. This is a very natural setup to introduce these four-body terms and to so the whole architecture of this triangle that we've seen reduces to very simple elements. So with this, I'm actually finished. So I think in the series of lectures, we started from the very basic foundations on adiabatic adiabaticity to Born and Fock. Then we looked at different aspects like entanglement, these non-stochastic terms, a bit as an outlook on what annealing can hopefully do. And then in the last session, I hope we learned a bit about these parity constraints and how one could actually implement annealing with a whole lot of other qubit platforms, not just the flux qubits. I think this the interesting part about this is that it opens the field to qubit platforms which are highly developed. So we can use all this adiabatic state preparation technology that has been developed in so many platforms also for annealing by decomposing the problem into a fully local one. And with this, I would like to finish.
Questions? Do you suspect that some of the qubit technologies are more or less inclined to different algorithms or simulations?
Yeah, so that's for sure. So that's also the big question. I mean, which qubit platform is, so to say, the best suited here, no? Because, for example, if you think about atoms or ions, they have, I mean, all qubit platforms have advantages and disadvantages, and I think most of them are also known. For example, how do transmons compare to atoms in terms of gates and fidelities, and what's the good to bad ratios for all of them? And I think what is interesting here about atoms, for example, is really that, I mean, you have to really think about which features can you use. And for example, for the atoms, what is interesting is that you can use this feature that you can write this into three sub lattices, no? Which can exist at the same time. So this is something that makes the atoms, for example, very attractive here. But it's something that you first have to think a bit about. No? So it's not something that you get for free. And then, for example, for the transmons, what we've seen is that they have, of course, much larger lifetimes than the flux qubits. So there, the hope would be really, so in all of my work, I'm really thinking about going coherent. On the other hand, the transmons are also very difficult to couple in sigma c, sigma c. So the natural coupling is exchange coupling, so making the signal C, signal C was quite a challenge. And I, if you look in this paper, this was most of the work that's actually done by Martin. And so all of these qubits have advantages and disadvantages. And this is also very interesting. So it's not clear where this is going.
If not, let's thank Professor Lechner for almost back-to-back lectures today.
Thanks.